This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I am glad that you've chosen to join us this morning in our worship experience, and we have a lesson that we want to share with you. But before we share it, let us pray and ask God's blessings on our time together. Eternal God, our Father, we are so glad that you have given us a reasonable portion of health and strength. And Lord, you are the God that goes before us. And Father, we pray that you give us clarity of thought and clarity of speech. And we pray that your will be done in each one of our hearts and that you would be glorified. And Lord, as you've taught us to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
In this very room, there's quite enough love for is quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very room. And in this very room, there's quite enough love for all of us. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all of us. And there's quite enough hope, yes, there's quite enough hope to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, in this very room, and in this very room, there's quite enough love for all the world. And in this very room, there's quite enough joy for all the world. And there's quite enough hope and quite enough power to chase away any gloom. For Jesus, Lord Jesus, is in this very
we want to talk to you a little bit this morning about a new start, a new start. And each day that we get up, we get a new start. We don't know what is going to happen in the course of that day, though we make plans, but sometimes those plans go awry. In our daily lives, we have choices. We can sow to our flesh or we can sow to our spirit, in our actions or in our thoughts. We plant seeds that affect the type of person that we're becoming and the level of impact that we have on other people's lives because of Jesus Christ. God has given each person a history that depicts their life experiences, whether it was fruitful or unproductive. We all have a life and we all have experiences. It is our history and how we have come to this place and time in our lives. And in that, we have stories based upon our experiences. Your story is unique and you can have the greatest impact on a person as you share from your heart's experience. You have a greater impact than a person who is perhaps telling the story about your life. People may have similar experiences that they can relate to in a way that no written script could, because you have your feelings involved in your story. There is hope for the hungry soul because they can feel the sincerity of your heart as you share how God has blessed you over your lifetime. They may not respond immediately to your story or to your testimony of how God has dealt with you, but you can believe and be assured that they're going to have something to think about. Galatians 6:8, for he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will reap that which is of the Spirit, and it is into everlasting life. Our scripture text is found this morning in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 17 through 21, and I will, at the conclusion of reading the scripture text, we'll go verse by verse. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses, your trespass, my trespass, against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, all becomes new. Regardless of a person's place in life, regardless of a person's history, regardless of their station and what they've done in the past, if any person, man, girl, boy, woman, if any person be in Christ, they are a new creation, and God is able to work in their lives. Some institutions can change a person's behavior, but only Christ can change a person's character. We all have been a part of different cultures that have influenced us to develop some very unhealthy habits. And we can talk about those. And those habits can take us into different directions and different courses in life that are good and that may not be so good. When we truly surrender our hearts to Jesus Christ, he creates within us a desire to please God in everything that we do. We begin to live a life of purpose and meaning. We no longer depend on our own thinking. If it seems right, then it's good to do. If it's right, if it feels right, if it sounds right, then it's okay to do it. Well, the Bible tells us that there is a way that seems right to a man, but the end leads to the way of destruction. Before Christ, our hearts and desires would pull us in all different directions to please ourselves in this world. We thank God for Jesus Christ, who has given us a new heart, of flesh, that in our hearts we desire to bring glory to God and to please God the Father. Psalms 9:1 says, I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart. I will tell of all the marvelous things you have done. So we come from a heart of disbelief, a heart of unbelief, and a heart that is filled with discouragement and self-abatement. And we come with a heart full of praise and thanksgiving to God. A heart that we used to have, we didn't give God much credit. We didn't give God any glory. Matter of fact, we cursed the day that we were born, and our hearts have been transformed into praising and blessing God. Verse 18, all this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. God reconciled us, and he has given us the message and the hope and the ministry of reconciling others to him. God never gives up on you. He never gives up on you. We give up on ourselves, but he never gives up on us, for he longs for you to come to him and be free from the slavery of sin. That means that we were slaves to our habits, slaves to our culture that maybe was counter the will of God. Maybe it was against the will of God. The things that we learned, the things that we did were against the will of God. So we no longer are in a slave condition. We have come out of condemnation that was in the world, and we've come to know Jesus Christ. God wants you to know that you are his best creation. He loves you with all of your imperfections. Hello. Sometimes we have difficulty loving ourselves. God still loves you. And he has a purpose for everything that happens in your life. He knew the cost needed to bring you and I back to him, his best work. We were created in his image and in his likeness. And so why wouldn't he give the best to restore us into a relationship that was for ongoing and everlasting? The world in all of its beauty does not compare to you because, again, you were created in his likeness and his image. Don't withhold your story of how God has brought you into relationship with him through Jesus Christ. It matters to God. It should also matter to you that people are living and leaving this life without receiving the greatest gift that God has given to mankind. And that gift is in his son, Jesus Christ, who gives each person who receives him eternal life. People living in darkness are looking for light to shine so that they may come to it and be saved. Whether they want to acknowledge or not, they need and hope for a better life. You and I may be the only light who gives people a way out of darkness, the light of Christ that lives inside of us. Verse 19, that is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses, our trespasses, against us or against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. God loves you. God loves you. God has sent his son to die for you. God sent his son to be buried for you. God sent his son to be raised from the grave for you with eternal life in his hands. When you love someone, you freely share how your love has been impacted by that person. Oh, tell me something. When you are in love with someone, you share your story of how that person has impacted your life and how you have impacted that individual's life. You are elated over your relationship and what that person means to you. You do it and you say it, and you're not ashamed of telling people how this person has impacted your life. You do it without hesitation. You're not embarrassed to share your joy because of this person coming into your life. I ask you, do you love him? Do you love the one that loves you, that died for you? Do you love him? If you do, your life will surely show it, and you will not be ashamed of what he has done in your life. If we live to witness, we live to witness to the world the joy of our salvation with a heart filled with thanksgiving. When Christ comes into your life, it's worth celebration. It's a time to rejoice. It's a time of relief and release. You are elated over the fact that God has come into your life. And if you lack joy, If you lack the joy of your salvation, then I would bid you to pray Psalms 51, verse 10 through 12. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me by your gracious spirit. So if you lack joy, pray, ask God to give you the joy of your life being transformed by the power of God. God sent Jesus into the world with full knowledge that some would fall in love with him and others would not. Others would despise him. He has given us a message of love, acceptance, forgiveness, redemption, and eternal life for all people. This is the message of reconciliation, that Jesus died and was buried and rose from the grave, that you and I might have eternal life. That is the message. He has given us a message, and that message we've shared with you, and we continue to share it with you. He really cares about you and what you are dealing with in your life. And we know that we live in a world that's under condemnation, but there is no condemnation to us. It's sad that people continue to choose and to reject the gift of eternal life in Christ, in spite of God's mercy and freely given grace. Romans 8, 1 and 2 says, there is therefore now no condemnation in those who are in Christ Jesus. If you've made Jesus your choice, there is no condemnation in regards to your past and your past life and your past deeds, because the Bible says, who the Son sets free is free indeed. And by his death, burial, and resurrection, he has come to free us from our sins and our habitual sins. And verse 2 says, for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. That is a law. That is a spiritual law. That is a natural law. We die because of our sins, because of Adam and Eve's sin, death came, and death has come upon every living creature upon this earth. Verse 20, therefore we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. God is using your life and my life to make his appeal to other people in regards to how we live this life and how we testify of God's dealings with our lives. We implore you on behalf of Christ to be reconciled to God, verse 20. That is our method and motive of operation. We appeal to those who do not know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. God uses the things that happen, our experiences that happen in life to you and me. God uses those experiences as a representation of his grace, and we in turn will bring glory to God as we go through this life and as we experience trials and tribulations and disappointments, and how we manage and how we maneuver through those with Christ being in our lives. He uses those experiences that we may testify to others of his good grace and his mercy. He is glorified when we accept Christ as our personal Savior and live for him. I live for the Lord. And whether I live or die, I am the Lord's. He is glorified when we accept Christ as our personal Savior. When other people observe your life, they know that you are different because of how you respond to ongoing challenges and situations that occur. In this world, you shall have trials and tribulations. But Jesus says, be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. So when we go through something and people see the confidence in our lives that this will pass and that we know that it didn't come to stay and that we trust God to see us through. Pray and ask God to give you a word to share with others about how God and how much God loves and cares for them. Realize that without the Holy Spirit and His anointing in our lives, we have nothing to say that can add or change any person's life. Verse 21 in closing, for our sake, He made Him, Jesus, to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. Think about that. You becoming the righteousness of God. You, an imperfect person, becoming the righteousness of God because of the Holy Spirit leading you and guiding you into all truth. And you are an ambassador of God's grace and mercy. It took the most purest person to cover the sins of my life and your life and our selfishness. It took Jesus. There is no other person born on earth to cover my sins and your sins for all eternity. It wasn't just for this moment, but He paid for our sins, our past and our present and our future sins. He died once and for all. People, it is not about religion. It's about relationship. God, who created you, He created you for relationship, not to be religious, but to have a relationship with God the Father through Jesus Christ, His Son. Do you have a relationship with Christ? When you are born in sin, the only way out of sin is through the blood of Jesus Christ and having a relationship with God, who was buried, who died, who was buried, and who rose from the grave, offering every single living being eternal life. You don't have to miss out on heaven. You just have to repent of your sins and receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior and be born of the Spirit. Ask the Lord to forgive you of your sins, turn away from them, and then seek the Lord daily as your personal Savior and asking for direction and guidance in His Word. Why be ruled by the pride of life and reject God's offer when God has made a way to fulfill your life? Why go the other way? Allow Him to fulfill your life and your purpose for which you were created for. And you will never be filled and fulfilled until you've come to discover that purpose. How long will it take you? How many near-death experiences do you need to convince you that God desires a better life for you now and eternally? Familiar passage of scripture as we close. John 3:16-17, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through Him. Your application, share your relationship about Christ as if your life depended upon it. Share what Jesus has done in your life. Share it with others, because there are a lot of desperate people looking for a reason to continue their life, who are desperate in such a way that they're willing to end their lives on their own terms, as opposed to looking to Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith and the sustainer of life. Each day, ask God to give you a word and opportunities to share what God has done in your life. And you will be the better for it, and you will be able to impact other people's lives and give them a reason to go on with their lives in spite of their condition or their situations. God bless you, and I pray that you receive this word and make today a new start for you. God bless you, love you, and I pray that He will take your life and use it for His glory. Until we meet again, may the peace of God, which surpasses human understanding, rest upon you, and may He use you for His kingdom work. God bless you.